Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Medford United Methodist Church. I know it's a little tight in here this morning, so you might have to squeeze even a little bit further together. I don't know. We'll see how it goes as people come in. But it is a great thing to welcome all of you here today. And my name is Joe Monahan. I'm the senior pastor here, and I want to welcome you on behalf of myself and also our associate pastor, Kathleen Stoles. We're really, really happy to welcome each and every one of you, especially those who are here to celebrate with one of these young people, these wonderful young people who are part of our confirmation class here today. We have a lot to celebrate today. I hope that each one of you will take a minute and sign the red attendance pad that's on the inside of the pew, that you'll pass it down. It's one of the ways that we get to know one another's names. And if you are visiting with us today, and if you'd like to find out more about the church, we'd love to be able to connect with you. If you're willing to share with us your name and address information, there's a block for that at the bottom of the page, and you can fill that in. And you can find out more about the church by looking at our website or stopping in the narthex out here outside the sanctuary. You can find a little rack with the information about various kinds of ministries that we do. So I hope that you'll take advantage of that. If you'd like to lift up a prayer request during worship today, there are also some white cards that are in the pews. You can fill one of those out, and we'll come around and collect those during the first hymn. I just want to say a couple of announcements. We just got back from annual conference. If you are Methodist, you know something about annual conference. It happens every year, first of all. And it's the opportunity that we have to gather together, churches all around New Jersey, get together to worship, to pray, to celebrate, to pass legislation, do all the things that we need to do. But also one of the things that happens there is we celebrate the appointment of clergy to ministries all up and down the state. And we are very happy to announce that we have been reappointed to this church for the next year. So we're very happy about that. It was a great thing for us to be there. We were there with one of our adult members, Leslie Congetter, but two also of our young adult and youth members. So we also had with us Brielle Hone and Alana Miller. And so that was a great thing. Actually, one of the reasons why Brielle was with us is we have some pictures here. Brielle received an award at the annual conference. She received what's called the Denman Evangelism Award. And it's a very prestigious award. It's only granted in every annual conference to an adult layperson, an adult clergy person, and then to a young person. And she was the recipient this year. She's in college at Cornell. And we also have another picture. Do we have another picture? So this was a picture that Brielle's mom and dad insisted that we take with all the clergy who have served this church that she's grown up with. And so this was a fun picture here. And also Claire is here, our senior high youth director. And so we're really excited about that. So a couple of announcements. If you come here next Sunday at 11, what you're going to see during worship will be our musical. Our young people put on a musical every year, and so that's what will happen during this worship service next week. So I hope that you'll come out and check that out. That'll be at 11. I want to announce that we have a special church conference that's coming up on June the 10th at 7 o'clock p.m. And specifically what that's for, it's to review and we hope approve the first phase of our planned expansion for our building program. And so what we're talking about doing is using the money that we have on hand to begin the utility and the site work and beginning that this summer. So that's what we'll be voting on at this special church conference. That's June the 10th at 7 o'clock p.m. But we're going to talk you through the program and how it proceeds from there. So I hope that you will come out and join us. A couple ways that you can be in mission with us this week. We've got the diaper drive that is continuing through Father's Day. We also have the opportunity coming up next Saturday. This sounds a little funny, but if you buy a ticket to the chicken barbecue, come out. You can also support mission that way. Not only through the work of the United Methodist Men who sponsor this, but also because we'll have a dunk tank and you'll have the opportunity to spend your money. And every dollar that comes in through that will go to A Future with Hope, which is our Hurricane Sandy relief and recovery ministry that's been happening in the Greater New Jersey Annual Conference for since 2012. So we are excited to have all of you here. And let's continue on now by singing our first hymn.
Jesus, my foundation, is Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Please be seated. And I invite you now to join me in our prayer. Adam was called to walk with God. Joseph was called to dream. Esther was called to free the faithful. Samuel was called to serve. Ruth was called to find new faith. Jeremiah was called to prophesy. David was called to slay giants. And Mary was called to bear God's own son. In their youth, their inexperience and their doubt, uncertain, unsure of the future before them, they heard and followed the call of God. Jesus called little ones to show the way to the kingdom, called a teenager to feed the hungry, called John into the desert ahead of him, called fishermen to a new occupation. Jesus called Nathanael to come and see a new way, called a young man from his tomb, called a 12-year-old girl to rise up and live, called the despised and rejected to be in his company. In their youth, their inexperience and their doubt, uncertain, unsure of the future before them, they heard and followed the call of Jesus. For Jesus saw and called out of them their optimism and imagination, their courage and adaptability, their hope and their idealism, their courage and their sensitivity, their wisdom and their faith. Now, even now, the Spirit calls the young to stand up for their faith in the face of persecution, to take their talents and their skills to places of danger, to raise their voices in songs of protest, to fan the fire of passionate ideals, to build communities of love and compassion, to teach the old, to dream new dreams, to minister and serve for the sake of the gospel. For in them are planted the seeds of new possibilities, the gifts of the years to come, the insights that will shape the future, the promises that all things will be made new. Amen. We counted up the bells, and there were 19 of them, right? I mean, that was amazing. That was amazing. So thank you so much to our senior bell ringers. The peace of Christ be with you. Let's take just a moment now to greet those around us with the peace of Christ. Time for our children to come forward. So do we have any children that would like to come up? I can always count on you, Tim. I'm so happy you're here today. Anybody else out there? Well, it's you and me, kid. Do you like books? I love books. And this is one of my favorites. Do you know this one? Peter Pan? No? Don't know Peter Pan? Well, sometimes when we read a book and then we get to the end of the book, we're kind of sad, aren't we, when the story's all finished? And then, you know the good thing, though? When one book is finished, we can start reading another book. So when we finish one, there's always a new beginning to another book. Isn't that a good thing? And when you get a little bit older and you start reading chapter books, you finish one chapter and then you go on to the next chapter. And I'm usually sad when my books are finished, but then I just pick up another book and sometimes it's even better than the one before. You know, there's lots of things that start and they have a beginning and then they have an ending. Another thing that has a beginning and an ending is a day. What happens when the day starts? Do you remember? You wake up and the sun comes up too, right? You wake up, the sun wakes up, and then what happens at the end of the day? You go to sleep, and the sun goes to sleep. That's right. And that keeps happening over and over again, doesn't it? And then if you get enough sleeps, if you get enough days, you have the days of the week and the months of the year, right? That's right, January 1st is your birthday. So when January starts, it starts with the 1st, and then the sun goes down and comes up and keeps coming down and coming up, and then you get all the way to the end of the month, and that's the end of the month, but a new month. And you know what's so great with all those things that start and then they end? God is there in the midst of every one of them. So whether you're reading this is May. That's right. Today is May 31st. So we are at the end of May. And next comes June. You are. Well, that's great. That's wonderful things to look forward to. So when the sun comes up that day, you know you're going to be going to the beach house, which is great. So the best thing about all that is God is there in the midst of every one of those days. Even the days that aren't so good, God's still there with you. So let's say a little prayer together, and then you can go back to your seat or you can go upstairs, okay? Gracious God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for new beginnings and new endings. And we know that you're there in the midst of all of them. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thanks a lot, Tim. We'll see you again.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Joshua. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the Israelites. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and the Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea in the west, shall be your territory. No one shall be able to stand against you all of the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land, and I swore to their ancestors to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to act in accordance with all the law that my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, so that you may be successful wherever you go. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to act in accordance with all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall be successful. I hereby command you, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened or dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Choir, that was great. Really great. So let's take some time and pray together now. God, we thank you for everything that you've done for us. I give you thanks today, especially for our confirmation class, and just ask that as we think about the scripture here this morning, think about what this day means, that you will be at work in our hearts, in our minds, and in our understandings. Lord, we are grateful for everything that you've done, and we pray that we might hear a word here this morning, that all the people who are gathered here might hear a word of encouragement for them, something that make them think and something that they can take away in order to live in the way that you would call us to live. Lord, we are grateful for your power at work in us. We pray these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. First of all, confirmation class, I would just want to say how much Kathleen and I have enjoyed working with you. We really have. We love you guys. And I enjoy working with the confirmation class every year. My own confirmation was really, let's say, it was less than perfect. It was actually quite boring and very forgettable. And so one of the things that we try to do between Bethany, Kathleen, and I, and all the adults who take part of this, all the confirmation mentors who are seated right here in the front, we try to make it fun, and we try to engage, and we really appreciate all of you engaging with us throughout the year, and we're really grateful for you. So I want to say, you know, I'm proud of you, and I'm impressed with what God is doing in your lives. I'm impressed with you, and just the best thing was to be able to sit with each one of you individually and talk with you. That's my favorite part. We do this every year. At the end of the program, Kathleen and Bethany and I sit with each one of the confirmands, and we have this opportunity to find out, you know, is this really what you want to do, right? And through that process, we get to see how much they've grown and they've learned and how they've changed over the course of the year. And I was amazed at how articulate this class was about their faith. In ways, honestly, I have had great, don't get me wrong, if you were in a previous confirmation class, I'm not saying anything. Every class is wonderful, and I love you all. But you all really had some amazing and wonderful things to say, and so I was very, very proud of you, and I am very proud of you. So you should know that. I forget who said it. I know it was one of the girls, but beyond that, I can't get any farther than that. But during our interview, somebody said, when we said, what is confirmation about? One of you said, it's about beginning a new chapter, right? It's about beginning a new chapter. Was that? I don't know who it was. It was Jess. There we go. It's about beginning a new chapter. And that has kind of stuck with me just throughout this whole week. And I've been thinking about that. What's it mean to begin a new chapter? And I think right after that, you also said, Jess, I know that from here it gets a little tougher. It gets more complicated. And I thought that that was incredibly wise as well. What I want you to do, how many of you, you are mostly 15, right? For the most part, 14 and 15, right? Not everybody, kind of a mix, 13, 14, 15. I want you all who are out there, who are maybe farther away from 13 or 14 and 15, I want you to think for a minute about what that was like. Can you remember it? Can you picture it? Like, not only externally picture it, but internally picture it, right? What did it feel like? Think about, you know, what it was like to get up and go to school every day, you know, to navigate friendships and what kind of a person you were and what kind of a person you were trying to be. You know, as we get older, we tend to look back at our time in middle school and high school, maybe not so much middle school, but definitely in high school, we tend to look back at that time and we say, wow, it's the greatest days, right? We didn't have that much responsibility, you know, we felt freer somehow. But I want to remind you, those 10 years, however you want to count them, between 14 and 24, 15 and 25, those are also some really hard years. Complicated years. Time when you're really trying to figure stuff out. John, when you're trying to figure out who you are, it's hard work to figure out who you are. Very hard work. So when we said things would get harder, I really resonated with that. I mean, think about it. The moral choices that you have to make at 14, 15 are much different than the moral choices that you had to make when you were 4 and 5, right? So it's like, can you get along with your brother and sister? Well, it's still a moral choice, right? Can you share toys with them, right? Are you going to leave somebody out when you're playing on the playground and somebody's sitting by themselves? You know, those are the kind of things that you're trying to learn at 4 and 5. They're still important, but it's gotten more complicated. So, really, you are young men, and you are young women now. Not really boys and girls anymore, right? And so, the question is, you know, how am I going to relate to my parents now? How do I relate to my parents? How do I relate to my siblings, to my friends? Like, how do I fit? What kind of people do I want to surround myself with, right? How do I relate to the opposite sex, right? These are more complicated questions than the ones that you had when you were 4 and 5 years old. But I want to offer you this word of encouragement today, and that is, just like Jess said, it is not a new book. It is a new chapter, right? So when you pick up a book, how many, do you guys like to read or no? No, I really don't. When you pick up a new book, though, it's like entering into a brand new universe, right? It's a brand new story. I mean, literally, it can be entering into a new universe. But, you know, within that book, there are these chapters. And, you know, the chapter is going to have a start, a middle, and an end. And the end of this chapter leads to the beginning of the next one. And so on and so on and so on. Until we get to the end, until we get to page 999 or whatever, right? Wherever we end up. It's this continuum. Each thing leading to the next. The scripture lesson today is from the first chapter of the book of Joshua. It's kind of unfortunate that we call books of the Bible because it undermines my argument. But there are also chapters in the Bible, which helps me. But the idea being that if you picked up on it, Joshua is picking up where Moses left off. So Moses' job that God gave him was to lead his people out of slavery in Egypt into this land that God had promised them. That was Moses' job. But Moses died before the job could be done. And somebody else had to pick it up. It was the beginning of a new chapter, the start of something new. And so as we read this, we find all these promises that God is making to Joshua as he's getting started on something new. And if you read through it, the promises are really very simple. It comes down to three things. The instructions are pretty clear. First, be courageous, right? It's not always easy to be courageous, to live out your faith, because it's not always easy necessarily to make choices that are different from your friends, the people around you. Those are not easy things to do. But God says, be courageous. The second thing is, follow all the things that I have taught you. So that's not me speaking, that's God speaking. Follow all the things that God has taught you. Understand that if you want to move into the promised land, if you want to be in that place where God has prepared for you, in other words, if you want to fulfill everything that God has in mind for you, part of what's required is we have to follow God's way and walk in that path if we're going to get there. And then the third thing is, know that I am going with you. I'm with you. And it doesn't just say that once in this passage. It says it like three times. Know that I will never leave you, that I will never forsake you. Do you remember what we said about grace? The idea that God is always kind of calling you before you ever even know you're being called. Right? You all were able to answer the question about prevenient grace, right? So if you haven't been in confirmation class for a while, these are some of the words that we use. We use this fancy word, prevenient grace. The idea that God is always reaching out for us before we ever know what God is doing. God always has in mind to bring us home. That's always God's plan. That's always what God is about. That's the reason why we baptize infants. We had the blessing of, in the last service, we just baptized a baby. We baptized that child knowing that he doesn't necessarily understand what that's about right now, although who knows what's going on in a baby's mind? We don't know. But then we know that, no, it doesn't appear that he understands what's going on, except that his head was wet and he didn't like it all that much. But that's God knocking. Before we ever understand, God knows. God calls us. And that's what happens with us. And that's one of the reasons why, actually, we use the same, very same liturgy. I'm going to turn to the same page in the hymnal to go through the confirmation liturgy here. Because baptism, confirmation, it's all part of the same story. It's the same book, a different chapter. Same book, different chapter. And this story continues throughout your life. But these three things will serve you no matter what. Be courageous. Keep to the path that God has for you. And know that God always, always, always goes with you, no matter what. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Giving is one of the ways we express our love for God, and it's one of the ways that we learn to serve God's people. And like I said at the beginning of worship, Kathleen and I just came back from our annual conference, and one of the things I actually love about annual conference is the offering at annual conference. I know that that sounds weird, but we always raise an amazing amount of money for whatever it is that we're doing. And our local churches this year brought an offering of $100,000 for A Future with Hope, which is our Hurricane Sandy recovery ministry that's sponsored by the Greater New Jersey Annual Conference. Actually, originally we showed up with $96,000, but there was a spontaneous offering on the floor with the idea that we were going to get to $100,000 one way or the other. And it was led in part, actually, by Alana, who's sitting up here in the choir. She went to all of the young people who were seated at the front of the hall, and she collected money from them. She shook them down until she got $150. And then, so altogether, we ended up raising $108,000 for A Future with Hope, which is wonderful. And so I'm hoping that a little bit of that might happen today, in the sense that last week we had something called our Pentecost Challenge. We had a donor who came forward and said that they were going to give us they were going to match dollar for dollar up to $5,000 if we could raise $5,000 on Pentecost Sunday. And we need, I think, about another $500 to reach our goal of $5,000 and to get this full match. So if you didn't have an opportunity to participate in that last week and you'd like to this week, you can take one of the blue envelopes that are in the pews and just mark it Pentecost, drop it in the offering plate. If you are visiting with us today, if you are our guest today, we just want to say thank you so much for being here. You don't need to feel under any obligation to give anything to us today. We're happy to see you, and we would love to see you again. So let's continue by offering our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings.
I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Christ.
pray with me. Our Lord, giver of life and source of freedom, we know that all we have received is from your hand. Gracious and loving God, you call us to be stewards of your abundance, the caretakers of all you have entrusted to us. Help us to always use your gifts wisely and teach us to share them generously. Send the Holy Spirit to work through us, bringing your message to those we serve. May our faithful stewardship bear witness to the love of Jesus Christ in our lives. May we pray with grateful hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated.
Let's take some time now to pray together. God, we're grateful for this day. We're grateful for everybody who's gathered here. And we're especially grateful for our confirmation class. And just ask your blessing upon each one of them, individually and together as a group. We're grateful for all the ways in which you've already blessed them with unique talents and gifts and skills and personalities for doing your work here on earth. Lord, we pray that as a church, we can continue to nurture them in their faith and encourage them in their growth and continue to be a place where they can wrestle with what it means to be who they are and to be loved unconditionally by you and by the people around them. God, we're grateful for that opportunity to be that kind of environment for young people. And we pray that we might always live into that, so that people can know that the church is a place where you can come and be who you are and be loved. We ask nothing more. We ask nothing less either. Lord, we are grateful for all of those who have come and gathered today. And we ask for each life, each spirit present here, that you'll bless us and encourage us and send us forth with hope. Encourage us so that we might be encouragers to the young people in our lives, to our kids, to our grandkids, to our nieces and nephews, and kids in our neighborhoods, kids in our schools. Lord, enable us to be encouragers. Lord, we give you thanks that you have loved us so much through Jesus, and we offer our prayers today for healing and for protection for all those who are on our prayer list, and especially today for Neil, as he deals with cancer, as his family deals with this cancer diagnosis. We pray for Hannah today, who was in an accident and has some injury to her leg and to her foot. And so we ask just for healing for her, and that you would watch over her. Young person, same age as those who are being confirmed today. Lord, we pray for the people of Houston today, people who have suffered damage from flooding. We know what that's like, having seen the effect of Sandy on our state, and the fact that here, even years later, we are still trying to recover and help people get back into their homes. Lord, we pray for the people of Nepal today as they continue to wrestle with how best to go forward after devastating earthquake. God, we ask your blessing upon this world, upon nations throughout the Middle East, other places where there is no peace. God, we ask that we as a nation and we as individuals might be peacemakers wherever we go and everything that we do. God, we're grateful for the opportunity that you've given us to be a part of your kingdom, to be representatives, your representatives, as we go out into the world. We pray that for our young people. Pray that you continue to encourage them, bless them, give them vision for how you're calling them to serve, and bless us so that we might understand how you want to use us. Lord, we pray this in the name of and through the power of your Son, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now we have the great privilege to begin our confirmation today. So Kathleen, I'll invite you to come and join me here in the front. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation, and we're given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift, and it's offered to us without price.
Through confirmation and through the reaffirmation of our faith, we renew the covenant declared at our baptism, acknowledge what God is doing for us, and affirm our commitment to Christ's holy church.
And now I present Carl Albert Hauser, Gerald Thomas Hewitt, Eric Austin Kennedy, Alyssa Hollis Maggs, Alexander David Mann, Derek Charles Martin, Andrew Davis Palmer, Olivia Rose Saratella, Jessica Louise Trauger, and Thomas Carl Vassallo for confirmation.
So on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? Do you accept the freedom and the power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world?
Now do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
We do.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you in your care?
With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness, that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life.
Now,
go ahead. Sorry.
Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in both the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
And do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended to the Father, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Carl Albert Hauser is an eighth grader at Medford Memorial Middle School and will attend Shawnee High School in the fall. He loves playing jazz trumpet and is in the pit band for the school musicals. Carl is athletic and enjoys skiing, soccer, running 5Ks, and being on the cross-country team. In addition, he enjoys building anything, robotics, and flying remote control planes. When asked to describe Carl, his family said that he is musical, a dreamer, intelligent, and kind. And he's really close to being the best trumpet player in this church. Just gonna throw that out there. During his year of confirmation, Carl has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. I would like to share two statements of belief that he has recently written. Carl believes that because of sin, we are human and not divine. Additionally, Carl believes that through the scripture, tradition, experience, and reason, the Wesleyan quadrilateral should be consulted in making the right decisions. And now that he has a better understanding of what he believes, Carl is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Carl Albert Hauser, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Gerald Thomas Hewitt is an eighth grader at Lumberton Middle School and will attend Rancocas Valley High School in the fall. He's very athletic and enjoys playing baseball, soccer, and fishing. When asked to describe Jerry, his family said he is thoughtful and hardworking. During this year of confirmation, Jerry has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. I would like to share two statements of belief he has recently written. Jerry believes that the Holy Spirit surrounds us and uses its power to help us make the right decisions. Additionally, Jerry believes that God's grace surrounds us in our lives daily. When we don't think it is there, it is, and when we don't deserve it, we are given it. And now that he has a better understanding of what he believes, Jerry is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Jerry, remember your baptism and be thankful. Gerald Thomas, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Eric Erectorset Kennedy is graduating from Medford Methodist Middle School and will attend Shawnee High School in the fall. He plays the drums in a rock band and the Shawnee Drumline and is also very active in the Boy Scouts. When asked to describe Eric, his family said he is intelligent, funny, and he has a good work ethic. Good scout. During his year of confirmation, Eric has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. Two statements of belief he has recently written include this belief that the Holy Spirit is always with us and guides us. And he also believes that as disciples of Christ, we must follow him in order to stop all wrongdoing. With his better understanding of what he believes, Eric is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Eric, remember your baptism and be thankful. The Holy Spirit work within you, Eric, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Alyssa Hollis Maggs is an eighth grader at Lumberton Middle School and will attend Rancocas Valley Regional High School in the fall. She is very athletic and enjoys playing on the Haynesport soccer team and school field hockey team. Alyssa enjoys hanging out with friends and traveling, and she also plays the flute. I think I did know that. When asked to describe Alyssa, her family said that she is quick-witted, which I completely agree with, and fun-loving. During her year of confirmation, Alyssa has spent time exploring what her faith means to her. I would like to share two statements of belief that she has recently written. Alyssa believes that God has a purpose for everything we need to do and to care for all of God's creation. Additionally, Alyssa believes that Christ loves us so much that he allows us to be redeemed by crossing the bridges that he has made to save us from sin. And now that she has a better understanding of what she believes, Alyssa is ready to take her vow of confirmation.
Alyssa, remember your baptism and be thankful. Alyssa, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Alexander David Mann is an eighth grader at Medford Memorial Middle School and will attend Shawnee High School in the fall. Alex enjoys playing football, fishing, and hanging with his friends and family. When asked to describe Alex, his family said he is kind, smart, and athletic. During his year of confirmation, Alex has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. I would like to share two statements of belief that he has recently written. Alex believes that God creates us all in his image and has a plan for everyone. Additionally, Alex believes that when living a holy life, we should remember that no one is perfect and that we should always try to improve and help others. And now that he has a better understanding of what he believes, Alex is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Alexander, the Holy Spirit work within you. Having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Derek the Header Martin is graduating from Medford Memorial Middle School and will attend Shawnee High School in the fall. He enjoys anything having to do with technology and computers, likes learning and investing, the stock market, and science. He loves playing soccer in any season, indoor and outdoor, in any kind of weather, literally. He also likes to spend time with friends, swim, bike, fish, and attend summer camp. When asked to describe Derek, his family said he is active, talkative, and happy. During his year of confirmation, Derek has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. Two statements of belief he has recently written include his belief that the church is a united group of people helping others and each other. And he also believes that grace is a gift we don't deserve, but we receive anyway. With his better understanding of what he believes, Derek is ready to take this vow of confirmation.
Derek, remember your baptism and be thankful. Derek, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Andrew Davis Palmer is an eighth grader at Marlton Middle School and will attend Cherokee High School in the fall. His interests include engineering, building and design, aerospace, and Top Gear. Andrew also is athletic and likes to play basketball and is involved in competitive swimming. When asked to describe Andrew, his family said he is inquisitive and intelligent. He has a strong work ethic and a great sense of humor. During his year of confirmation, Andrew has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. I would like to share two statements of belief he has recently written. Andrew believes that all people are redeemed if they feel guilty, are actually sorry, and try not to do it again. Additionally, Andrew believes that scripture, tradition, experience, and reason have taught him many things and is a great way to solve problems. And now that he has a better understanding of what he believes, Andrew is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Andrew, remember your baptism and be thankful. Andrew, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Andrew, congratulations. Olivia Rose Saratella is an eighth grader at Medford Memorial Middle School and will attend Shawnee High School in the fall. Olivia enjoys playing basketball, listening to music, and spending time with friends. When asked to describe Olivia, her family said she is friendly, kind, and conscientious. During her year of confirmation, Olivia has spent time exploring what her faith means to her. I would like to share two statements of belief she has recently written. Olivia believes that everyone sins, but everyone always has the option to reject it. Additionally, Olivia believes that the sacraments make us one with Christ. And now that she has a better understanding of what she believes, Olivia is ready to take her vow of confirmation.
Olivia, remember your baptism and be thankful. Olivia, the Holy Spirit worked within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Congratulations.
See you.
Congratulations.
Jessica Louise Trauger is an eighth grader at Harrington Middle School and will attend Lenape High School in the fall. She is athletic and participates in soccer and track. She also enjoys spending time with friends, going to parties, and watching Netflix. When asked to describe Jess, her family said she is compassionate, tenacious, and loyal. During her year of confirmation, Jess has spent time exploring what her faith means to her. I would like to share two statements of belief she has recently written. Jess believes that the church is one of the best ways for people to gather together spiritually. Additionally, Jess believes that when we live a holy life, we allow God to guide us on the right path and not worry about being perfect. And now that she has a better understanding of what she believes, Jess is ready to take her vow of confirmation.
Jessica, remember your baptism and be thankful.
You want to come around, darling?
Yeah, come around. Perfect. Jessica, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ.
Thomas Carl Visalo is an eighth grader at Marlton Middle School and will attend Cherokee High School in the fall. He enjoys playing soccer, listening to music, reading, and playing piano. When asked to describe Thomas, his family said he is bright, fair-minded, helpful, and warm-hearted. During his year of confirmation, Thomas has spent time exploring what his faith means to him. I would like to share two statements of belief he has recently written. Thomas believes all churches look different, but they are all a place where Christians can come together and be at peace. Additionally, Thomas believes that worshiping God can be in a small group or a large one, loud or quiet, but it is all to praise the Creator. And now that he has a better understanding of what he believes, Thomas is ready to take his vow of confirmation.
Thomas, remember your baptism and be thankful. Thomas, the Holy Spirit work within you, that having been born by water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Started the service. So we just have a few more questions for you. As members of Christ Universal Church, will you be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, please say, I will. As members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and to your care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, to confirm their hope, and to perfect them in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And now may the God of all grace, who has called us to eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and in peace. Amen. Can we welcome our 2015 confirmation class? Then there's a hymn.
Should we tell them?
We'll tell them. That's fine. Go forth from this place to take courage, to walk in the path that God has for you, and to know that whatever happens, wherever you go, God goes with you. Go forth in Christ's name to love and serve God and your neighbor in everything that you do. Amen.